Good.
Good morning, everyone. Can everyone hear me? All right. It's so wonderful to join a meeting into those words, that to focus on the power of God. And we're very excited. I'm Brother Lucas. I know that there might be some people that maybe have joined from across the country this morning. And this is a beautiful, beautiful thing. I'll share just a brief thought as we come together and we look across and see the names and faces. And I was even laughing to myself as I want to welcome everyone name by name, but that would involve me welcoming LG device and welcoming iPad and welcoming this and that. But we're so glad that you took the time out of your Sunday and your Father's Day to be with us. And we know that God will bless you. You know, through the journey that we've had together with the pandemic and the challenges that have been before us, we have had to adjust. And one of the things that as a branch talked and we were starting to invite guests to come and share a message from God, you know, Brother Joe Inyani has sort of bridged the gap between Fort Worth, Texas and Lake Worth, Florida, based on his family situation and his commuting. And we were talking just as a ministry of how nice it would be to just sort of combine efforts and have him be a guest speaker. And he leveraged that. He turned around and said, well, if I'm going to come and speak to Lake Worth, and you brothers have to come and speak to Fort Worth. And then we thought, you know, let's just get together and maybe see some names and faces that we haven't seen before. And that alone is a blessing, that we're all on our journey together, but we can feel that unity and that spirit of God. And so I'm just going to start with a few brief announcements. Because we have, you know, not just Fort Worth and Lake Worth, and we have other visitors from around the country. I'm just looking through here, and I know I'll miss, so I won't, you know, point people out, but I see, you know, Michigan, I see New Jersey, I see, you know, all over the country. So it's just such a blessing. We have a mini conference here, which is exciting. And I know that you've supported us through your prayer and through your thoughts as a ministry, that we would continue to make good decisions, that we would continue to do our best. So continue that this morning for Brother Joe. And I will start by saying, remember in Lake Worth, remember our prayer email list. We send that out weekly. Remember to pray for those. One that we added last night as we got word that Sister Ruthie's daughter, Sister Kim, was Perkle, and I'm sure I'll butcher her last name, but Pokowski, was tested positive for COVID-19. She's had to work continuously through the fire department doing her job as an inspector, and she was tested positive this past week. So pray for her in addition to our prayer list. And then the other announcements we will save for the end in terms of our upcoming events and activities. For those, I believe everyone on here knows Brother Joe Inyani. I can't say enough about this brother. I love him so much, and I will pump him up gladly for a moment because he is a worker for the Lord. He is, for me, just an amazing spirit-filled balance of knowledge, a wealth of knowledge, and relatability, and passion, and just focused on Jesus Christ, and having such a mindset for people and outreach and anything we can do to further the kingdom. And so I'm just so blessed that we will have a few words from him after he's done speaking. We'll have a song that we will all sing along in our own homes. And then we will have some time for a testimony and sharing and praising God together. So that's our plan for today. Brother Joe, I'll turn it over to you, and you can take it from here.
Blue one.
Brother Joe, I can't hear you, so I think you need to unmute first. And remember, we'll open in prayer.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Can we first open in prayer, my brother? Would you open us in prayer?
Sure. Let's all unite. Lord God, we thank you for this day, and even the first thoughts that come to our mind is, naturally speaking, we take this time to recognize fathers and those that have been both natural and spiritual fathers, those that have been mentors, those that have come in and fathered moments of our life where we've needed guidance and direction. And so we thank you for that, Father. We thank you for those men that have come alongside us. But Father, more than anything else, we thank you for you as our Heavenly Father, for who you are, for the great I Am that you are, that you are the right thing at the right time in our lives. And we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, that we have a relationship that we can look to, that we have an opportunity before us, that we can continue to do our best, and even when we fall short, that you come and fill that gap. And so we put this day in your hands, Lord, that not only would Brother Joe be blessed as he brings forth a message from your word, from the word of God, but Father, that we would open our hearts and minds, that it would fill us, that we would continue to be the light in our corner, wherever it is right now, Father, first in our homes, in our communities, and anyone that we would pass, that we would continue to show a little bit more your love in the world that's around us, that's hurting and broken and ill. Father, we ask for healing and health and progress and perspective, Lord. We ask that you would bless each and everyone that's here. We ask that you would continue to allow your work to progress, your kingdom to grow, both here and abroad. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, everybody. And Brother Lucas, thank you for those kind words, but it's you're either talking about another brother or any good in me, it comes from our Lord and Savior. All the good in this church comes from God, and I just want to praise him as we start. And tell you, I'm so excited to be here today. I am just thrilled. Those who know me know that I like to move and walk around, and I feel trapped here, but I might jump out of my chair at a certain point. So anyway, God bless you, and I'm thrilled to have this gathering. You know, I've been in Dallas-Fort Worth for over 30 years, and I love those brothers and sisters so, so much. And I've been blessed to be able to travel a bit and to come and visit Florida and to visit Lake Worth. And I found just such marvelous brothers and sisters there. So today we have a chance to merge together and with the two branches and all the brothers and sisters in Christ and our friends from across the country, thank you for coming. God bless you for coming, and pray that God will bless everything that's said and done in every part of our service today. Because the Lord wants to bless us. He wants to touch your soul today. Open yourselves up to Jesus Christ and his Holy Spirit today. And let me tell you what my theme is. And I will say, it's probably never been more important. At this moment, the time we are living in, the crisis or crises that we're going through, we need, and this is my theme, we need to be real believers, true believers, faithful believers. And in fact, the phrase that keeps coming to my mind is believing believers, believing believers. Now you might say that's redundant, but brothers and sisters and friends, I mean that we need to be the men and women who don't just believe there's a God or believe he's done great things at other times for other people. But we believe in him to our cores, to our souls. He's not just the God or Lord. He's our Lord. He's our Savior. And he is mighty to save. And he wants to save and help us every day of our lives. He wants to save our souls. And he wants to guide us through life. I want us to be believing believers. And that certainly includes me, brothers and sisters and friends. And the scripture that I want to read today is actually one of my favorite in the Bible, because while it took place 2,000 years ago, it is so modern. It is so up to date, because I know that I fall into the situation that we're going to talk about. And my guess is that you do too, at least from time to time. So the scripture I'm going to read is found in the book of Acts, Acts the 12th chapter. And beginning in the very first verse, Acts 12, number 1, verse 1. But let me give you a tiny bit of background as I go into this. So this takes place, the story we're about to talk about, this amazing, amazing miracle and experiences are about to happen. They take place about 10 to 14 years after the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. About 10 to 14 years after the day of Pentecost, after when the church was started. And we see here, the church is being blessed, but the evil one wants to come in. He wants to disturb and torment the church of Jesus Christ. And it says in Acts 12:1, now about that time, Herod, the king, stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the church. Now this Herod is not the Herod that lived in Jesus' time, not at his birth or not at his death. It's a later Herod. But he decides he wants to torment and harass the church. And because of that, it says in the second verse, he killed James, the brother of John. And because he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to take Peter also, the apostle Peter. Then were the days of unleavened bread. And let me just quickly mention at this point, it's the days of unleavened bread, which means it's the days of Passover and the same time period of Easter. And I'm sure that Herod didn't care about those things. He's imprisoning, he's killed one of the apostles, he's imprisoned another apostle. But I don't think what he understood truly was that this time of year is a time that represents freedom, not imprisonment, but freedom. The Passover representing when the spirit of death passed over those of Israel, the house of Israel. And after that, Pharaoh said, leave. And Moses and the house of Israel were given freedom to leave Egypt. And in the days of Christ, the Last Supper, Passover, and then his death and his resurrection, which represents to this very day, freedom from sin. If we will claim it, if we will grab hold of it, that Jesus Christ died on that cross so we could be free of all of our mistakes, all of our sins, all the errors of our life, to now live with him and someday live in paradise forevermore with Jesus and our Lord and our God. So to me, when I see Passover, when I see the days of unleavened bread, it screams out freedom if we take hold of it. But Herod doesn't understand that, I'm sure. And he has Peter in prison. And it says in the fourth verse, when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and he delivered him to four quaternions of soldiers, which means four groups of four soldiers. He put 16 soldiers to watch Peter, to watch him in prison, 16. And when the church heard this, just like today, we're in a crisis. When the church heard this, it says in the fifth verse that prayer was made without ceasing of the church of God for him. The church turned to prayer. They had lost one of their leaders and another one was now in jail. So they began praying and praying without ceasing, without stopping. But Peter was not the Peter of old, the Peter who denied Christ by this point. God had changed this man and he had become a man of faith. It says in the sixth verse that, and when Herod would have brought him forth, the same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains. And the keepers before the door kept the prison. So it is the night before Peter is going to be brought forth, maybe before Herod, and possibly killed the very next day. And he has guards around him, two on each side, one on each side. And possibly he's chained to both of those guards in this innermost prison. And what is he doing? Knowing he's surrounded by men who want to harm him and kill him, and he might die the next day, he's sleeping. That's what the faith of God can do for you. He's not afraid. He's not fearful. He's sleeping. And he doesn't know what's going to happen. I'm sure he assumed he was going to die, but he's still sleeping. But that's not God's plan for Peter and for the church. It says in the seventh verse, "And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shone in the prison. And he smote," this angel's had a smite, had to hit Peter, knock him, shake him, stir him, to raise him. Because my impression is he was sleeping so deeply that the angel had to shake him to awaken him. And the angel tells him, "Arise quickly." And when he did, the chains fell from his hands. He was set free. The chains fell from his hands. And the angel then guides him out. The next few verses talks about the angel guiding him out of this prison, going from room to room, putting on clothes, and then leaving from ward to ward to ward. And the ninth verse, it actually says that Peter, I'm sure in part because he'd been sleeping so deeply, didn't even know what was occurring, wasn't even sure if it was real. It says he thought it was possibly he was having a vision. He was seeing a vision, his freedom being released by this angel. But the angel kept guiding him from room to room. And then finally in the 10th verse, it says they came to the outer gate of the prison, which was open to them of his own accord. God literally opened the door to the prison. And Peter and the angel leave and are now in the streets. And the angel departs. And in the 11th verse, it tells us, finally, Peter said, "Now I know of a surety that the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me out of the hand of Herod." Upon the streets of Jerusalem, he finally knows for sure it's not a dream, it's not a hope, it's not a vision. I am free. And where does Peter want to go? Where should we want to go in a crisis? What should we want to do when we have good news? He wants to go to church. He wants to be with his brothers and sisters in Christ. In the 12th verse, it says, "And once he had considered this thing, he came to the house of Mary," not Mary his mother, but Mary the mother of John, "where many were gathered together praying." The brothers and sisters were praying for Peter, certainly praying for his release. And that's where he wants to go. And it says in the 13th verse that Peter, he knocked at the door, and a damsel came to hearken, whose name was Rhoda. And when she saw him, when Rhoda saw Peter at the gate and heard his voice, she opened not the gate for gladness, but ran in and told how Peter stood before the gate. So she sees him, and she's so excited, she doesn't actually let him in, but she runs into the where everybody is and wants to tell them, "Peter's here, Peter's at the gate." And this is where I'm going to end this. The last few two verses I want to read here, the end of the story that I want to focus on, it says, "And they said unto her," when she goes into the room and she sees the brothers and sisters praying, "and they said unto Rhoda, thou art mad." In other words, you're crazy. You're crazy, Rhoda. But she constantly affirmed that it was even so. She kept saying, "No, it's true, it's true." Then they said unto her, "It is his angel." In other words, "It can't be him, Rhoda. You're crazy. You're crazy. And we don't believe you." And then, "Well, maybe you're seeing an angel, but you're not seeing Peter." So brothers and sisters and friends, not to pick on these people, because I've been there. But these brothers and sisters, at this moment, we're unbelieving believers. Unbelieving believers. It's almost comical. They're praying that Peter will be released. Rhoda comes in to tell them she's released, and they're saying, leave us alone. We're praying that Peter will be released, okay? So even while they're praying for his release, when he's released, they don't accept it. They don't believe it. So brothers and sisters, and it says in the last verse, 16th verse, Peter keeps knocking. And when they opened the door, they saw him, and they were astonished. Brothers and sisters, we don't want to be unbelieving believers. We want to be believing believers. I know that sometimes, while we believe in God, we love God. But when we pray, we're just going through the motions. We're praying because we're supposed to pray. We're going through the steps. But we're not really believing it's going to happen. Sometimes our faith isn't great enough. And we know God can do it, but we think he's not going to do it for us. I don't believe it's going to happen for us or for me. We're just like these men and women who are praying for Peter, but we probably were afraid. We're nervous. We're seeing bad things happen. We're in a crisis, and their faith had dropped. Well, I want to tell you this morning, I want to tell you, and some of you have heard me say this before, because God gave me this message in January. He told me in January this theme that we need as a people, we need to feed our faith and to starve our fear. To feed our faith and to starve our fear. That those two things are inversely proportional. When our faith goes up, our fear goes down. Or when our fear goes down, our faith goes up. He knew that this year would be a year of crisis, of trouble, of problems. And he wanted me to share with everyone, increase your faith. Don't be afraid. Don't be frightened by anything. And I'll tell you in a moment how you need to do that. But let me just read one more verse to you today. This is found in 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy, the first chapter, the 7th verse. It says, again, 2 Timothy 1:7, for God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. That's what our Lord and Savior wants us to focus on, his power and his love. And that's how you gain your faith. And that's how you shrink your fear. In other words, if you're feeling anxious or nervous or afraid, when the evil one is trying to discourage you, don't focus on the negative. Don't focus on why it's not going to happen, why it won't happen. Don't worry. Don't go through your mind all the bad things in your life. Instead, focus on God, the power of God, what God has done for you already in your lives, and what he can still do in your lives. Focus on the stories of the scriptures. Focus on what he did for Peter. He is a God who can break every chain, brothers and sisters and friends. He can break every chain. He's a chain breaker. We have to believe it, trust in him, focus on his power, focus on his love, focus on what he's promised us, what he's promised the church of Jesus Christ. The negative thoughts, the second they come in your brain, start thinking about the good thoughts. Start thinking about God. Pick up the word of God, read it, remind yourself of his promises, remind you of the miracles in his scripture. It doesn't matter what you're facing. And brothers and sisters and friends, I know at certain points in our lives, and maybe today, we feel like we're in prison. We feel imprisoned. We feel like we're in a cell. And I know for each one of us, it's different things. It can be our job situation. It can be our relationship, this relationships in our lives with our wife, our boyfriends, our girlfriends, our family, our sons and our daughters. It can be addictions of any kind, drugs, alcohol, our addictions to things, to our phone. It can be anything. It can be illness and sickness. The list goes on and on. And sometimes we feel trapped. We feel like we have chains upon us. We feel like there's no way out. But brothers and sisters, what I'm telling you is often there's a miracle at the gate. There's a miracle at the door. Go answer it. Open it up. Open up to Jesus Christ. Open up to our God. Let him in. He can set you free. He can break every chain. You know, I know there's experiences in the church, and I've witnessed a few times. For example, my nephew, Jason Macknick, he was once in a meeting where he wasn't sure if he should get baptized. And we prayed upon him. My brothers and I prayed upon him. And we said, break the chains that are holding him down. And brothers and sisters and friends, Jason and others in that group heard the crash of chains falling to the ground. And he stood up and he asked for his baptism. Whatever's holding you back, don't let it. You know, you might say, well, I've lost. I've tried these things. I've tried to break the chains. They don't break. Brothers and sisters and friends, ask for a rematch. Ask for a rematch with your problems. But bring God with you. Bring Jesus with you. And he can break every chain. He can turn your life around. He can set you free. He can set you free today. I don't care what you're dealing with. Our God is greater. He is able to do all things. And it can be a literal prison. It can be in your mind. But he can break down the doors. And let me tell you one more experience. One more experience today. Because I want to hear from others. I want to hear you tell us how God is going to change you. Or how God has changed you. I want to hear my brothers and sisters in Christ this day. But let me tell you. This experience of Peter happened 2,000 years ago. But I experienced something very similar about 20 years ago. Our branch was doing a work in Laredo, Texas. And that's 7 or 8 hours from Fort Worth. But brothers like Brother Jeff Gennetti, Brother Juan de la Cruz, Brother Tom D'Orazio, and others, and Brother Joel Monsivais were doing this work 7 or 8 hours from our homes. And we were told by two visitors, a couple from our branch, we were told, we hear you're going to go to Laredo next week. They said, our son has been arrested there, and he's in jail there, and we cannot communicate with him, and we don't even know why he's there, but maybe you could go and give him encouraging words. You could go visit him. So when we went that following week, on the Saturday we were there, Brother Joel Monsivais and myself, and let me tell you, Brother Joel, I love you, my brother. I love you, my brother. But Brother Joel and myself, we went to that jail. And we found it in the city of Laredo. We went to the jail, we walked up on the porch, and we saw there was no door that would normally open that we could open. But in fact, I believe we tried to open it, and it didn't open. And there was a little intercom. And this person spoke to us, and they said, you know, can we help you? And I said, we want to go visit this young man in jail. And the police officer, the guard said, you can't, you're not allowed in. And I said, I'm a minister from the Church of Jesus Christ. I just want to speak to him as a minister talking to this young man for a few minutes. And they said, no one is allowed in this jail. So I looked at Brother Joel, and I said, we can't go in. But that doesn't mean God can't go into that prison, that God can't send his angels into that prison. So on that porch, Brother Joel and I bowed our heads, and we said a prayer. And we asked, I was hoping that those police officers or guards were listening to our prayer. And I prayed, and I said, Lord, go into this prison this very hour and let this young man know that he's loved, that it's not hopeless, that he can be freed, and that there's a God. Let him know he's not alone. And I pray, God, free him. Free him from this prison. Free him from this jail. And then we left. That week, we got news that within a few days of our prayer, this young man said, somebody came to his cell and opened the door and said, you are free to go. You're free to go. He said, what? He said, you are free to go. Please leave. And he said, he walked out of that jail, door after door open for him. No one said anything but, please leave. You're free to go. He filled out no paperwork, nothing of the sort. He just walked out onto the streets of Laredo. And brothers and sisters, I thought to myself, when I heard that, I thought, I wonder if he was like Peter, who said, is this a vision? Is this a dream? No, it's of God. It's the power of God that had set him free. And when those two visitors to our church, the parents of this young man, found out, they joined the Church of Jesus Christ. And they have been faithful and wonderful members of the Church of Jesus Christ for the last 20 years. And their son left that jail, and he's been a wonderful, productive member of society. And our hope and prayer is that someday he'll join the Church of Jesus Christ. But our God is a chain breaker. If we believe, if we truly believe, let us be believing believers. At this time, let us not be afraid of what's to come. Let us know that God is with us, that God is going to help us through this crisis and whatever's to come. He can save us. He is mighty to save, brothers and sisters. And whatever you're dealing with, or whatever is going to be your next prison cell, let God release you. Let God set you free. Believe and trust to the cores of your soul, and God will break every chain. May God bless you all. I love you all.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Joe. Such beautiful words. You know, we're going to go into our praise and testimony, and I just want to follow up with one thought, 60 seconds. You know, I'm very transparent and very open. My notebook is filled, Brother Joe. I have lines and scribbles and circles and stars and exclamation points, and you finished with one phrase that I just couldn't let go. I just couldn't. You said, "Let God set you free." And that resonated with me so much, because the response to when the door opened is what you're talking about. The believing believer, that's the difference between the unbelieving believer and the believing believer. The response to see it and accept it. You know, sometimes you hear stories of an inmate who spent so long in prison that when they get out, they do something to go right back in. In our lives, we sometimes have gotten so much in a routine that even when the change through God comes, we don't grab it. We don't claim it, like you said. And that's our challenge for me and for you, is when there's an opportunity, a spark, a catalyst, a change, that we let go of what we've been holding on to. Sometimes the chains are holding us, but sometimes we're holding the chains because that's all we've known to do. That's all we've done for so long. And you mentioned these things: relationships, habits, addictions, significant visible things. But it's also the invisible, the intangible, the mindsets, the attitudes, the perspectives, the feelings, the this, the that, the anything that comes between me and God, that sometimes it's holding us, but sometimes we're holding it just because that's all we've ever known, or that's something we've developed, a habit, a defense mechanism, a self-preservation. And man, God just put on my heart is, as the chains come off, we got to let them go as well. And so our letting go today is just to praise and thank God for who he is and what he's done and what we've heard. And I'm just so blessed, brother. Thank you. It's so great to hear your voice. So great to see you. We also have the challenge now of managing, and a beautiful challenge of managing a testimony with 73, not in the pews. It's one thing when two people stand up in the pews and we're able to facilitate that. So we're going to do our best, brothers and sisters. I'm going to, and as we talked and prepared, Brother Ken Lombardo was invited, and he managed to swing the whole Metuchen branch over with us. So Brother Ken Lombardo, I'm going to ask you if you would start our testimony meeting with just a quick thought and word of prayer. I see so many brothers and sisters. So please, we want to hear from as many as possible. Be brief, be praise oriented. Remember to unmute. If you unmute and start talking with at the same time as five other people, praise God. We'll deal with it. We'll figure it out, because we want to hear from as many as possible. God bless you.
What a pleasure it is to be here. Our apologies for coming in about 10 minutes late. Our branch had joined with Columbus this morning. There's a brother, Juan Carlos Daguaf, was present, preaching to us from Colombia. It was a great time. But we could see as the 11:30 was coming on that we were going to have to leave. But the Lord worked it out, and we came in just as you were praying this morning. And as Brother Joe was beginning to speak, I found myself looking at every picture and just being blessed by seeing who's here from. Like, I wanted to say, hi, sister, hi, brother. Such a wonderful message, though, probably among, you know, my top five scriptures, because we can relate so easily to the doubt of Peter when God was answering his prayer, to the doubt of the people who were praying for that very thing. You know, her son had just been murdered by Herod. So when they went to the home of the mother, you know, they were praying about that, but I don't think they were much hopeful. There's an old song too that's a little too jazzy for me to have ever sung, but it was a Larnell Harris song, and it's called Rhoda, Open the Door. And when I first heard that song, it turned me to that scripture, and I read that scripture for the first time. And I love the expression, because it says that because of happiness, she didn't open the door, she ran in back to tell them because of happiness, and they said that she was crazy. And I find so many times when we're suffering in the pandemic or the loss of our jobs or whatever throughout our lives, anything that's ever happened, problems within our families, things that we think are insurmountable and we don't have much hope, and we'll say to each other, well, we'll pray about it. You pray about it. It's almost the throwaway expression, because deep inside, we don't really have an answer. But what a great message for us all today to be lifted up in faith and to be coming away from this time of believing. We gain strength from you, brothers and sisters. Today, we're happy to be here and just blessed beyond expression. May God bless you as I pray today.
Brothers and sisters, I have to thank and praise God today. What I'm going to tell you is actually kind of unbelievable, but I hope you believe me. Yesterday morning, I woke up before my husband and I got up, and I went into the living room and prayed, and then I went into the kitchen, and I have an electric water kettle, and usually I just, I take the kettle, and if there's just a little water from the day before, I dump it out in the sink, and you know, otherwise if there's a lot of water, and I go in back into the living room and I water some plant. And I don't look into it except once every, I don't know, month and a half, when I have to descale it. But yesterday morning, I opened up the top right in front of me, and I saw something at the bottom of the pot. And it was this very large oleander leaf. Now, I know that oleander is poisonous. And I thought, how did this get here? But I was still kind of almost asleep, and I took it out. I dumped out the water, and I just like refilled the kettle, and I put it back to boil. And I came to my computer, and I looked up oleander, because I didn't really know what parts of it were poisonous. Well, the flowers are poisonous, the leaves are poisonous, the branches are poisonous, everything about the plant is poisonous. So I couldn't believe it. I thought, how did this get in here? So I went back, and first I thank God. I said, thank you, Lord, because I don't know how long this has been here, but at the very least, if it was just dropped here right now, you've spared my life, because I haven't touched it. But otherwise, if I've had it, I want to thank you also. But I started almost like to shake, and so I thought, well, first I thought maybe I should clean this pot a little bit better. And so the water had boiled, and I just picked it up and I put some soap into it, and I started to swirl it without closing the pot. So then I poured boiling water all over my hand, but it didn't turn red. It didn't get scalded. There's nothing wrong with my hand. So again, God blessed me further. But then I started thinking about this oleander leaf. Now I have two oleander bushes, but because I live in Michigan, if I haven't told you who I am, I'm Sister Patty Inyani Macnick from Detroit Branch 1. I'm actually Brother Joe's sister. And I have these plants, but because I live in Michigan, in the wintertime, I bring them in the house. And then in the summertime, I take them out And these are one of the plants that if my kettle is too full, I come and I water. So I started thinking about it and I thought, you know, I watered those plants. And actually at one point, because I don't want to wait for it to pour through the spout, I literally take the top off and so I have more water coming through. And I thought, I actually saw a leaf go in there once and I took it out and I didn't think anything about it. So I'm thinking that's how this leaf got into my kettle. But the thing is, I took these plants out 3 weeks ago. So this leaf has been in my kettle for at least 3 weeks. And I have been drinking poison for 3 weeks. And the Lord has chosen to spare me. And not only me, because my husband has taken water from the kettle once I boiled it. And even my 21-month-old granddaughter comes to me all the time and says, Nonna, can I have tea? She says, tea, more tea. And so he has touched all of us and spared all of us. We have had no symptoms, no illness, because the symptoms of oleander poisoning are blurry vision, nausea, diarrhea, confusion, low blood pressure because it causes cardiac arrest. We've had nothing. So I want to thank God today because I know he protects us every day and he watches over us. And most of the time we don't know. But I know the Lord was watching over me and my family, and I want to thank him and praise his name. And I want to thank him for all of you, and I want to thank him for allowing me to be here to see you all and having this time to get closer to God, to going from branch to branch and meeting to meeting. I live 3 hours from my branch, and this has been such a blessing to me that I just want to praise his name. And I'm sorry I've taken so much time, but I just had to thank him. And God bless you all. I love you so very much. This is my testimony.
Well, I'm thankful to be here today. I'm thankful for the message and for all that God does. I'm thankful that he, for the reminder to just feed our faith over fear. That was such a timely and beautiful reminder for me, and God always knows what we need. I'm full of thanks for the way that God blesses you and me and the way that he sees what we need even when we're not sure that we need it.
I want to thank God. For those of you that don't know me, I'm Sister Darlene from Fort Worth and Lake Worth. And I've been profoundly moved by the testimonies, God blessing my sister-in-law and protecting her and our family, thank God. But the message is especially poignant to me as I was listening in the other room to my husband preach. It reminded me of a time that I was newly baptized. I'd been in the church a little over a year or two maybe, and I was still a college student, and there was a part of me that was struggling to stay on the path that I had committed myself to after I was baptized. And I was struggling because there was a part of me that wanted to return to my old ways, and like a dog returning to its vomit, as the scripture tells us, there was a part of me that was really, really having a hard time. And I remember being at a conference in Greensburg and sitting in the congregation. It was full, and I was sitting way in the back, maybe second or third pew from the back, and just looking at everybody singing and feeling in my heart that I was not really a part of it, that there was something that had separated me from the Lord, and that I knew in my heart that I'd been disobedient. And like I said, returning to sin in many ways. And as I was sitting there listening to the preaching, I sat with my hands in my lap, and I remember saying to God in my mind, God, I can't do it. It's too hard. I feel like I'm in chains and that I can't do what you want me to do and be what you want me to be. And as soon as I thought that, my hands could not move. It felt like something, they were in a vice and I couldn't move them. They literally felt like they were in chain. And I leaned over to Joe and I said, Joe, I can't move my arms. I can't move my arms. And I knew it was God showing me in a literally in a tactile way that I was putting myself in those chains, that he had made me free when I went into the waters of baptism at the Detroit River. But I was choosing the chains. I was choosing the sin. But through him, I was free. And as soon as I recognized, I immediately apologized. Oh, Lord, I know I put those chains on myself. Please forgive me, Lord. Help me. And as soon as I said that in my mind, my hands broke free and I threw my arms up in the air. And Joe sat next to me. He's like, what's going on? And I just through tears explained to him that God in his mercy was showing me I didn't need to go back to my old ways, that he would help me and walk by my side. And that was now, gosh, 35 years ago, that experience. And I don't look back. I don't look back with regret. And I've made many mistakes along the way, and I continue to make mistakes every day. But any chains that I have, and those are those mental chains, Lucas, those are sometimes so much more insidious, aren't they, than the ones that people can see, are the ones that are in our heart and on our mind. God can help me break free of those, and he does all the time. I simply have to ask. So I thank God today for his love and his mercy and for this beautiful meeting that we are all seeing each other today. I thank God for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
I too want to praise God today. I'm so grateful for the opportunity to be with our brothers and sisters from different parts of the country. And I too am so grateful for this opportunity to take this time over these last 3 months to spend more time with him and to use our time a little more wisely. It's been enormously apparent to me how much time the Lord gives us and how much time I've wasted. And I'm so grateful for, it's crazy, I'm grateful for this quarantine that we've been in, because it's given me a greater sense and a greater desire to be in his word and to talk with others more. You know, it's provided the opportunity, like Sister Patty said, to be in all these different meetings and to spend more time with brothers and sisters throughout the country. And it's been an enormous blessing for me. And even though we're in a situation where, you know, Jeremy isn't working right now, I'm grateful for the opportunity that the Lord has prepared us, even financially for this time, that we're okay. And I'm grateful for that. And I'm grateful for the time that I've had a chance to spend with other brothers and sisters, even one-on-one, throughout this time. We've had some opportunities to Bible study and other things like that. And I'm so grateful, so incredibly grateful for feeling so much closer to him than I have in a long time. And I'm very, very grateful for that.
I want to thank God too today. Yesterday I wasn't feeling good at all. And I spoke with Brother Jeremy, and I called Brother Greg, and he says, why don't you go to the hospital? And I says, no. If I go to the hospital, they're going to keep me again, and I don't want to be there. Because this is my second bout with the pancreatic surgeries. So I didn't want to go. But I started praying, and I started praying to the Lord for others. I started asking him about others, Lord. This one and that one. And people's faces would come to me, and I kept praying for people. And I kept saying, Lord, bless them and watch over them. Provide for them, Lord, they stand in need. And little by little, the pain started going away. And I thought, well, that's what the scripture says. If you pray for others, you will receive. So I started to receive, and I thank God for that, because this has been a long, drawn-out affair. And the doctors have told me it's going to take time. Mr. Buffett, it takes time. You have to give your pancreas time to adjust, because you know, they had to relocate it. And so it has to adjust to that place where they put it. And so it's been a long, long drawn out affair. And being in the hospital with this COVID, it's not easy at all, brothers and sisters. I pray for those that are helping us, trying to help us in the hospitals, the doctors and the nurses. They have to be masked all the time. When you have to be masked all the time, you have to stay in your room, and it's horrible. It's horrible, horrible. 15, I think I was there 15 days in my room, and it was too much. It was just too much. But thank God I made it through that, and the Lord has been with me, and I'm so thankful that he's with me because I feel his spirit. And looking at all your faces, I want to thank you for your prayers. All of you, I saw, see you all online, and God bless you all. I thank God for you because we're all brothers and sisters in Christ. And that's what makes us different. I can't wait to get back to the building. I can't wait to praise God. Even though I praise him in our home, I praise him in our car, we praise him when we have dinner, we praise him for everything he does for us. But to be together and to share the word of God together in unity with pure love. That's what the Lord has shown me in my life, love. Love ye one another as I have loved you. And that's what I try to prove to everyone that I've come in contact with. We're all from Noah. We must love one another as brothers and sisters in Christ, even though they're not family members of the Church of Jesus Christ. We have to love them. God bless you, brothers and sisters, and thank you for your prayers. I can't thank you enough as I look across the screen and I see your faces. And they're precious to me. God bless you. Is my prayer.
I want to sit and thank God today. This is Brother Mike and Sister Donna from Fort Worth. And my heart is pounding today. I love those kind of services and I love that feeling. And I miss that feeling. I miss that feeling when we're together and we're testifying. And you know, I just want to thank the Lord today for being my Heavenly Father. He's perfect, and he's taught me so much about how to be an earthly father. And I want to thank him for that, and how to be an earthly husband, and how to be a better man, and how to be a better person in society. And I want to thank him for that as well. But you know, my heart's really pounding today because, Brother Joe, I loved your message, and I just kept thinking, let Jesus in. Let Jesus in. Let Jesus in. He's going to take care of it. He'll be with you in the prison so you can sleep. And what I love, you know, when we were talking about the angel, I'm thinking, wow, angels are great. You know, they're such good people, and they always bring good tidings. You know, they're wonderful, right? But at the end of the chapter, he kind of takes care of Herod, doesn't he? He takes care of that problem for Peter. There's no more problem anymore. He gets them out of jail, and he takes care of the problem, and they can move forward. And I want to thank God for that, because when I've let Jesus into my life, when we've let Jesus into our lives, amazing things happen. Miracles happen. I don't want to make it just personal, but, you know, amazing things happen to me. Amazing things happen at work. Amazing things happen in my family. He solves problems. He gives us patience. He gives us endurance. He keeps us away from oleander leaves in our water and our kettle. I'm going to start looking at my kettle, sister, and see what's in there. But he puts marriages back together. He reconciles families. You know, one of the most amazing events in my family was the day my father died, and it was in April, and our family had been estranged. Estranged since the Lord. And you know, when my father passed away, we were all by his side, and there was a nice minister there, a Baptist minister, and he said a prayer, and he looked at me, and we were holding hands, and he said, Mike, would you like to say something? And I said, I would like to pray. So we bowed and we prayed, and I honestly, I don't remember what I prayed, but all I remember, and it was kind of like when we were with that woman at Food Bank and praying for her the other day, Jerry and Juan. I just heard tears. And Jesus came into that room and hearts were melted. And you know what? From that day forward, our family's been reconciled. And I want to thank God for that because we let Jesus in. Now, did I have great faith at that moment that the Lord was going to work a miracle? No, but he did, because he knew it was on our hearts, and he knows what we need even before we express it. Isn't that amazing? I want to thank him for that. So I just stand, and my wife and I stand as a testimony to the goodness of God. Wow, my heart's still beating. When we're faithful and we follow him, amazing things happen. And when we decide to go out on our own and do our own thing, really not good things happen. Not good things happen. And we end up back where we were. I call them cul-de-sacs of life. You know, you go down the road and you just keep going. And then before you know it, you have to come back, and he brings you back on the path. But how long you're in that cul-de-sac, it really is up to you. And when do you want to let God in? And the beautiful thing about this church is, when we left for a while and I walked back into those doors, it was like I never left. It was like I never left the church. It was like I never left the Lord. And he has blessed me amazingly and abundantly, and my wife as well, beyond any expectation. I remember Brother Juan prayed for me at that time and one time. And Brother Juan, your prayers have been answered. He has blessed us. And I also lost my job. I'm not worried, brothers and sisters. I just want the Lord to lead, guide, and direct. I have no fear. That doesn't matter. I know he's always taking care of me, and he always will. He's always taking care of my family, and he always will. He's the great provider. He's the perfect father. He knows what we need. He knows what I need, and I want to thank him today. He's a wonderful God. Thank you for this message today, Brother Joe. It's beautiful. My heart is still pounding. I love each and every one of you. I love this church. I love God. And as imperfect as we are, I strive to do better, to just let Jesus into every situation. And I know that it's going to be better. I know that my faith will be increased and my fears will be less. I thank you today, brothers and sisters, for this opportunity. I'm sorry it took so long, but I just felt the need to express what was on my heart today. God bless you.
Very thankful to be here and to listen to the words that were spoken. And I've been in many prisons in my life. Many of you know my testimony, and this last prison I was in was like solitary confinement. And I didn't know when I was going to get out, but those chains were loose, and I'm so thankful for that. And I'm so thankful as I sit next to my mother-in-law, and you also know that I recently lost my mother. And when things like that happen, you really treasure those around you, and I'm just really thankful for her. Well, she may not be a member of our church, she's definitely a believer. I'm just really thankful for her. And she raised a really good boy, and I'm thankful for that. I'm just thankful for all of you and to see so many of you today. So I go up for my 6 months follow-up test just to make sure that everything went well. And at that point, if it went well, they'll start to decrease medication. So if you would pray for me for that, I'd be so grateful. So like I said, I'm just thankful to be here.
I too want to give my testimony, and I won't take long as well, but I'm thankful to have my spiritual father, as well as my natural father. I want to say happy Father's Day to all those that are here. I want to thank you all as secondary fathers. We know we all have them, secondary moms and dads. And it's beautiful to see all the faces. I was kind of thumbing through who was on when I heard Metuchen was with us. And it's great to see your faces. I haven't seen you in about 2 years. You know, when I'm able to go to New Jersey, I try to, you know, pick new people to see and visit. And the last time I was there, I was with my Aunt Betty. And we just had a beautiful time of getting to see each other again. You know, she's not my natural aunt, but we've called her Aunt Betty, and along with Mary and Sherry as our cousins, because of the closeness, and we love them. And not just pointing them out, but the many other brothers and sisters. I see Sister Diane still on the K camera. And she's been a great friend, along with the many others who have given me texts or phone calls or even cards. We know it's through the love of our brothers and our sisters that we can make it through these ordeals. I've had a bunch of tests the past week from doctors and no results. It's like they're guessing. And I prayed to God that he would be my chief physician and he would take this from my body. And I want to be able to, you know, go back to normal. And it's always been my prayers to do a work for the church. You know, we were born and raised in the church and some of us kind of fluttered to the outside, but I thank God that he brought me back and I'm doing a work for the church. And I want to do more. And like I said, Brother Joe, I enjoyed the sermon which you gave today. You always have that excitement in you. It's almost like, I don't know, God is next to you and you're it's just great. And I know Brother Chuck, I know I'm not one to, when I preach, to preach loud or to, I don't want to say loud, but excitement time. And it's wonderful to hear the excitement and the testimonies. And our sister with this leaf, we know that God will be with us through any dangers that we come in contact in life, you know, on the roads or, and I just thank God. And I just ask you to all continue to keep me in your prayer. I go for more tests this week. And I, again, I'm not putting my faith and trust in man, but I'm asking God to be the chief physician because I know he could do all. And I just, like I said, I want to get back on my feet, you know, back with my family. And especially with the church. So may God bless you all.
Good morning, all of you. I want to extend my greetings from the great state of New Mexico. I think I'm the only one representing this state, so I got to say something about it. I really enjoyed the message this morning and all of your testimonies. I had to leave for a little while because I got a call from my kids who were wishing me happy Father's Day. But this is a wonderful medium that we have to be able to share and fellowship. And I know that God has given this to us. He's given us many gifts that sometimes we don't fully value. All that he does for us. As Brother Joe was giving this message, it occurred to me about something about prisons. And, you know, we see prison as a horrible thing, and it is. But may I give you a little different perspective in this sense, that if you had never been in prison, I don't think you'd fully appreciate what it means to be free. And for myself, I've had my own prisons that I've had to face. And I think it's helped me to value the freedom that the Lord has given me. And as I get older, I come to recognize the hand of God again and again and again. I was just reading a text this morning that I had received from a very dear friend, a former colleague. He married a Navajo, and he's had so much heartache and a lot of health challenges. And he was expressing such great discouragement, and it broke my heart. And so I wanted to write him something, and I thought about it, prayed about it. And there was a hymn that came to me, and I shared it with him, and it And I wanted to read a few of the words because it relates to Father's Day. He didn't have a good relationship with his dad like I did. But there's another father. And this is what I shared. It says, "I who am nothing, my father's a king. He rescues his children from sin, prepares me a banquet no prince could afford, and I am nothing, go in." It goes on, it just talks about our father, a king, and keeps reminding us, "I who am nothing." I relate to that. I who am nothing, my father is a king. May God bless you. Hope to see you all face to face one of these days again. And just been such a blessing to be a part of this. God bless you all.
Well, I want to take just a moment to thank God. I'd be remiss to not thank God on this Father's Day for my son. I know many on here have probably had issues with having kids and desperately wanted children. We got to the point got to the point where we thought we weren't going to have kids. And I'll never forget the day that I was on my way to work, and I was praying on my way, and I said to the Lord, I said, "Lord, I accept the fact that I'm not to be a father. That's my lot in life. I'll accept it. I'll be the greatest, craziest, zaniest uncle to my nieces and nephew, but I understand and I'll accept that I'm not to be a dad." And I kid you not, within 2 weeks, my wife came into the room one Sunday morning and showed me a pregnancy test, and we couldn't believe it. And we're very thankful, and it wasn't an easy pregnancy either, but what I always thank God for is that the day that came when she gave birth to Jack, she had so many troubles, and he tried to come at 30 weeks and he kept trying to come early and early and early, and thank God he stayed and he came out and he was, almost 7.5 pounds and was totally healthy. And I think she pushed 3 times and he came out. I mean, I said that thank God that he gave her such an easy labor after such a long pregnancy. But he is such a blessing. He's going to be 7 next month. And I just today thank God that not only can I say happy Father's Day to all of you fathers out there, and some of my spiritual fathers are even here on this call today. It's wonderful to see. Thank God that he gave our brothers the idea to do this today, because it is beautiful. And we can be able to do it again. But just got to say thank God for my little one and for all of our kids. And we thank him so much. So God bless you and I love you.
If there's a word to explain excitement, it would have to be the Church of Jesus Christ. I can't think of any other word. To be able to be in Ohio and then come and be here in Fort Worth, to go to Michigan, how God has prepared for us, even though we're in the midst of all this mess that's going on, we're still being spared and we're preaching the word of God, we're listening to it 2 or 3 times a week, more than I do when we're normal. So do I want to go back? Because I want to hug all of you, but I'm going to miss you. I look forward just as much to see your face as I do to hear the word of God. And today's message was a winner. How can you not say to be released from anything and to just be a saint of latter days? Next month will be 70 years that we are in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And though we were born and raised in the church, but you know what? I'm learning every day. I didn't realize I was so dumb. It took 70 years for me to get where I am, to know what I know. But I just want to praise God. I have nothing to complain about. I'm here. I'm satisfied with life. I love everything God has done for me. Yes, we've been through ups and downs. I lost Brother Augie at the age of 47. But through these lessons, I have learned a lot. And doing volunteer work, I'm telling you, that's how you get to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. When you look at somebody in hospice and you can give them comfort. So don't sit back because you've been in church a long time, or even sit back because you may not feel good. Because the more you give of yourself, the more he gives us the strength. This is the Church of Jesus Christ. Somehow I wish I could go outside, put a banner up in everybody's door, just because I want them to know that we are a member of the church. So your message this morning was wonderful. The experiences were such a blessing. My cup is full. In fact, I've got to go get another glass from the kitchen because I have water all over the floor now. But thank you, brothers and sisters, for blessing my life today, because you certainly are special to me. I wish I could embrace all of you right now and just hug you and bring you into the house. But thank you for showing up and coming to my home, and I look forward to going to yours again. God bless you.
I want to thank God today as well. The message of our brother. Just coming off the Columbus, this is such a beautiful spirit caring for his Father's Day. As a brother's experience out of prison, I had an experience many years ago. And I had a dream about a prison. And I've been in a prison before for work. That I was doing, and it's a place you just don't want to be. And I had this experience where the Lord showed me a prison, and at the doors of the prison, and they were about 35. They opened up the doors, and I looked in the prison. And when I looked, I seen it was the world. It was outside. It was streets and cars moving and people walking around. And I said, is there anyone here who wants to hear the gospel? And I said it about three times. I asked, is there anyone here? I called out in this experience. And a man approached me. He says, oh, I know someone who would. And I love Brother Larry Watson's testimony this afternoon. And it kind of triggered this in my mind. And this man said to me, I know who will hear and wants the gospel. And he goes, I'll be right back. And he brought to me this man, and he was short, and he was of the seed of Joseph. And he says, he wants to hear the gospel. The world is a prison, brothers and sisters, and the Lord has given us that power to preach this gospel to those who are held by the chains. I love the message today, and I love the enthusiasm and the testimonies that I hear today. God bless you all, and happy Father's Day to everyone.
Well, we thank you for all of you that had an opportunity to express yourselves. It's beautiful to hear the experiences, and we know that not everyone could. So we certainly look forward to, as we heard many people say, see you, whether again it's through the screen or in person, hopefully soon. So as we go towards wrapping up, I'm going to share a few announcements, and then I'm going to kick it over to Brother Jerry Morley, who had just a few brief announcements. We wanted to give you a few things for the future. In terms of Lake Worth, here our branch, we are going to continue our Summer in Psalms lessons this Wednesday. We thank Sister Christine for leading the lesson last week. It was beautiful. We wanted to let you know, in terms of reopening, you are going to hear that a little bit at a time, different pockets throughout the country will be reopening with the Quorum of 12 and the General Church guidelines that have been given to the ministry. Specific to Lake Worth, we're not at liberty to do that yet. We talked as a ministry and felt like with the way things are going in our county, with the numbers rising instead of falling, as well as many of the steps that we would need to take, it's not the right time. So pray for that. Our hope is that, hopefully within the next month or so, but we are watching daily, hoping that things and praying that things improve for that. And then the last thing I would say is, in terms of our announcements, is to save the date. Our GMBA camp-in is going to be released online, and it's going to be a variety of live meetings, of recorded meetings, of coffee talks, testimonies, music. And so that will be July 5th through the 10th. While it's focused on the young people, it's welcome for any family and friends, and prepare for that. And if you enjoyed today, which we know and pray all of you did, next week, we're going to flip the script a little bit. So Lake Worth played host, and Brother Joe, we appreciate so much your time and your spirit. Next week, Fort Worth will be hosting Brother Jerry, and then the Lake Worth ministry will be sharing a little bit. So Brother Jerry, any announcements that you feel to share before we close in prayer?
Thank you, Brother Lucas. Wow, what a wonderful day. Thank you for inviting us into your homes. I have been just watching people's homes. You have some beautiful homes. Thank you for welcoming us in, and the energy that we have felt, absolutely amazing. God is so good. We give him the honor and glory today. Grateful that we've had the opportunity to share this time. Looking forward to next week when we can all come together again. This has been a beautiful little mini conference. And the only thing I would like to see is a little bit more joy on our faces. You know, as a minister, we sit at the rostrum and we stare out in the congregation. And now Zoom gives us that opportunity as well. If we're so excited, let's be joyful. I want to see some smiles. If the love of God has really set you free, show it. It's a beautiful thing. God has loved each and every one of us. And we're so grateful for this technology. He knew this pandemic was coming. He provided a way. How good is our God? How wonderful is our Father? For Fort Worth, we want to remind you this Wednesday, Brother Larry Watson is going to be teaching us again. Everyone on this call is welcome to join us. Brother Larry started a lesson 2 weeks ago, touching a little bit on his trip to Israel. And he's going to be continuing not only a little travel log, but also sharing some scripture with us and some future expectations of the church. If you're interested, please, the instructions are on the Fort Worth branch website under our communications tab. Feel free to stop in if you just want to send one of us a text. We're happy to share the information. Brother Larry did a wonderful job 2 weeks ago. We're looking forward to it being there again. This afternoon at 3 o'clock Central, 4 p.m. Eastern, I don't know how that translates to New Mexico, but Sister Linda is going to be holding a Sunday school class for the children. If your kids want to join in, they are certainly welcome to join. Again, that link is on our communications webpage. And finally, I believe our branch ladies group is meeting on Thursday night this week, 7:30 Zoom usual time. All right. God bless each and every one of you. It has been a truly joyful time to be together. Fort Worth, we are also looking at reopening. Tarrant County's COVID counts have been going up, so we're a little reluctant to open up too soon. The ministry is going to be meeting to discuss the guidelines, and you'll be hearing more from us in the coming days. So God bless each and every one of you. Back to you, Brother Lucas.
All right. Brother Chuck Sr., will you close us in prayer?
Yeah, sure. It, as was mentioned before I pray, it was just wonderful to see page after page of people and faces and just see everybody. I'm certainly very thankful to have my mom with us today and all of you and to feel God's presence. Definitely a wonderful day. And I'm excited about us even getting together again next week. We have a special opportunity, as was mentioned, we have some from Lake Worth that certainly are continuing to pray to see God's direction. but we've also brought someone that used to be in Lake Worth, Tom Durazio, that used to be in Fort Worth as well. And he's going to be with us next week and is going to take the lead in our service. So we're very thankful for that next week. And let's just pray together. So let's bow our heads. Truly, Lord, we are thankful for this opportunity that you have given us to be together. We're thankful for the message. We're thankful for the chains that you have broken in all of our lives. We're thankful for the prisons that you have taken us out of. And I ask, O Father, that you would even be with us, even as we have heard your message today, that we could be like Paul and Silas, O Lord, that when we find ourselves in our prisons, that we would be singing unto you and praising unto you, knowing that you are going to help us through those situations in our lives, because we know times come that all of us will be facing different situations in prisons. And I ask, O Lord, that this message today of hope, this message today of love, this message today that you have given us will be able to give us strength to be able to go on and know that we can do all things with you, O Lord. We're thankful for the smiling faces. We're thankful for your continual upliftment in our lives. And I ask, Lord, that as you know each and every one of us, you know our situations, you know the many on this call that are even coming on board, Lord, with illnesses and different situations, the many that we have brought to you even in our lists that all of us have, Father, and the ones that have continued to be mentioned, even Kim, who's dealing with this situation because of her job that causes her to be in front of so many people, Lord, that we know there's so many of our members that on a daily basis in the medical and the different fields, O Lord, that have to face even more than we do. I ask that you continue to protect them, Father, and protect all of us, that we would be able to continue to do what we need to do, but more importantly than all, that we could be able to be those chain breakers, Father, and be able to allow others to know that there is hope in Jesus Christ. So thank you, Father. Be with all of us. Give us a wonderful rest of the day, allowing us to even celebrate our Father and celebrate you, who gives all the glory that you deserve, Father, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you be free from your bed?